Thank you, everyone, and welcome to tonight's event, Columbus Hero, Not Heathen, with Michael Knowles. I'm Grant Strobel, a law student here at the University of Notre Dame and National Chairman of Young Americans for Freedom. For those who don't know, Young Americans for Freedom introduces students to the conservative ideas of free enterprise, limited government, traditional values, and a strong national defense. I chose to go to Notre Dame Law School because it prides itself on standing for the truth, even when it is unpopular. For example, when the Catholic Church officials turned down invitations to join Martin Luther King Jr.'s rally in Chicago, Father Hesburgh didn't cower to politically correct pressure to stay home. Instead, he joined to stand for the truth. Sadly, 55 years later, Notre Dame is not living up to that ideal. Instead of standing for the truth, even when it's unpopular, it caved to the politically correct pressure with its decision to cover the Columbus murals in the main building. Instead of conveying the message that Notre Dame is proud of its identity and desires to engage the campus community in dialogue, it cowered to revisionist history, conveying to countless visitors to this campus that we are ashamed of who we are. This is why YAF launched a petition to uncover the murals. The petition now has 1,500 signatures from students, alumni, parents, and members of the Knights of Columbus, among others. You can still sign the petition at www.yafnd.com. This is also why we are having tonight's event, to have a thoughtful conversation on Christopher Columbus. But first, I'd like to thank the sponsors of this lecture tonight, Robert and Patricia Herbold, for sponsoring not only this lecture series, but countless lecture series across the country to bring intellectual diversity and conservatism to college campuses through Young America's Foundation. Without them, this event would not be possible. Now I'd like to introduce Luke Jones. Luke is the chairman of the Notre Dame YAF chapter and has been working around the clock tirelessly, pushing the petition, doing media interviews, and organizing this event. Luke is the fearless leader behind everything you see tonight. Please give Luke a warm welcome.
Michael Knowles hosts the Michael Knowles Show at the Daily Wire. In 2017, he wrote the number one national best-selling book, Reasons to Vote for Democrats, a comprehensive guide, which President Donald Trump hailed as a great book for your reading enjoyment. Before blank book fame, Michael studied history and Italian literature at Yale University, graduating with honors. At Yale, Michael rendered the first ever English translation of Machiavelli's play, The Girl from Andros. In 2017, he teamed up with acclaimed novelist and screenwriter Andrew Clavin to perform the 13-episode narrative podcast, Another Kingdom, which garnered nearly 2,000 five-star reviews by the release of its final installment. Rising to become one of the most popular arts podcasts of the year before being renewed for a second season. Michael appears regularly on Fox and Friends, EWTN, and One American News, among other television news programs. He has lectured at research institutes and universities throughout the United States, including the University of Pennsylvania, the University of Michigan, the University of Alabama, and many others. Vanity Fair has described Michael as a dapper, lib-triggering troll. Will you please all put your hands together and help me welcome Michael J. Knowles.
Thank Thank you very much. Thank you so much for coming out. All right. Oh, that's very kind of you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much, as always, to YAF for hosting. Thank you to Notre Dame for inviting me. Free speech is not totally dead yet. And I have to make a special thank you to Antifa. I have to thank them. They had promised that they were going to come and interrupt this talk tonight, and they didn't show up yet. I actually was sort of hoping for their mothers, that they would clear out for the afternoon so that their mothers could take away all of the Hot Pockets containers from the couch cushions. But their loss is our gain, and it seems as though we will be able to discuss this very important topic tonight uninterrupted. And this is one of my favorite topics. It is such a pleasure to be here to discuss one of the greatest men in all of history, Christopher Columbus. And where better to discuss Christopher Columbus, a devout Catholic, than here at the Catholic University Notre Dame, named after Our Lady, to whom Columbus had particular devotion. This university is blessed in many ways. It is particularly blessed in the beautiful murals that it has from the 19th century, painted by the Vatican portraitist Luigi Gregori. Those murals depict Christopher Columbus, the brave and brilliant Italian explorer who discovered America. The murals have been painted at the entrance to the main building of the university as a reminder to all of us of the courage, curiosity, and moral purpose that sit at the heart of liberal education. Unfortunately, the leadership of this university has chosen to sneer at this blessing and this fitting symbol of liberal education. Just last month, Notre Dame President Father John Jenkins made the morally and pedagogically indefensible decision to cover up those murals so that nobody can see them. Now, in a certain sense, this decision is perfectly fitting of the spirit of our times. In 2019, is there any clearer picture of how far our educational system has fallen than for an American university president to cover up art and history with a giant tarp, lest reality offend the ignorant and the unreasonable? In his letter of January 20th to the Notre Dame community, Father Jenkins wrote, quote, "In recent years, many have come to see the murals as at best blind to the consequences of Columbus's voyage for the indigenous peoples who inhabited the New World, and at worst, demeaning toward them. Art and history, Father Jenkins seems to say, are to be permitted only if the majority of any given mob approves of them." He goes on, quote, "I have decided, after consultation with the university's Board of Fellows, on a course that will preserve the murals, but will not display them regularly in their current location." Father Jenkins expects us, it seems, to be grateful that he will not personally destroy the murals with his own hands. He will not, as an American university president, personally take a sledgehammer to art and history as would any Taliban commander. We should be so grateful. Regardless, though, we will not be permitted actually to view the murals, for very long at least. According to Father Jenkins, art and history are simply too much to bear for the fragile minds at this university. Now, why has Father Jenkins not simply moved the murals, you ask? Well, because the murals, luckily, were painted directly on the wall. So, and any attempt to move them would destroy them forever, a step that the university is unwilling, as of yet, to take. Yet is the operative and terrifying word. Just last week, Father Jenkins announced that he had formed a committee to advise, quote, "on the place to display the images of the murals and the appropriate communication around the display." Art by committee. What could possibly go wrong? Will Father Jenkins apply this anti-intellectual approach to other works of art? I, for one, don't like modern art because of how terrible it is. Can we expect Father Jenkins to form another committee to cover up the university's modern art collection? Can we expect him to throw a tarp over Georgia O'Keeffe's sexually provocative work? How many more committees will be formed to censor art? How many more committees will be formed to censor history at an alleged institution of higher learning, no less? History, after all, is what we're really here to speak about this evening. Specifically, we are here to correct the anti-historical nonsense swirling around the life of Christopher Columbus. Nothing so typifies the American left's present wave of statue-toppling, anti-historical hysteria as its war against Christopher Columbus. If you've been out of the news, over the past few years, a 25-year-old woman was arrested for vandalizing a statue of Columbus in San Jose, California. The word murderer was spray-painted on a statue of Columbus in Binghamton, New York. In Minneapolis, a petition circulated to replace a statue of Columbus at the state capitol with a statue of the late pop star Prince. A Columbus statue in Yonkers, New York was beheaded. That's no good. New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio created a commission to decide whether and how to remove the famous statue of Christopher Columbus from Columbus Circle, right next to Central Park. The LA City Council voted unanimously to rename Columbus Day as Indigenous Peoples Day, whatever that means, whatever particular indigenous people they're referring to. I don't think they know either. Seattle, Albuquerque, Denver, Phoenix, Santa Fe, and Ann Arbor, among other cities, have also all renamed Columbus Day Indigenous Peoples Day. The Wikipedia page for Christopher Columbus, if you go on it right now, is locked. You cannot edit it, because left-wing revisionists have tried to make the man appear so controversial. Why does the left hate this poor old Genoese sailor so very much? They hate him because Christopher Columbus embodies Western civilization. A transnational, devoutly Christian illiterate of low birth, an autodidact, and the greatest navigator of his age, Columbus spent nearly a decade doggedly attempting to convince the Portuguese and later Spanish crowns to fund his impossibly ambitious vision, at long last to success. He fulfilled Seneca's prophecy that a new world would be discovered across the sea. He helped to found the modern era, and he played the single most important role in the founding of America. So in a phrase, Christopher Columbus is everything the left hates. To give you an example of the left-wing anti-history and willful ignorance on the subject of Columbus, take just this one 2015 article from Vox.com. You might be able to intuit where this is going. This was on Vox.com, written by Dylan Matthews, headlined with Vox's typical sobriety, quote, "Nine Reasons Columbus Was a Murderer, Tyrant, and Scoundrel." Now, perhaps the worst charge in the entire article that Matthews alleges is that, quote, "Settlers under Columbus sold 9- and 10-year-old girls into sexual slavery." Matthews asserts, quote, "This one he admitted himself in a letter to Doña Juana de la Torre, a friend of the Spanish queen. Quote, "There are plenty of dealers who go about looking for girls. Those from 9 to 10 are now in demand, and for all ages a good price must be paid." Oh, you would think from Vox's article that Columbus hatched the plan himself, at least that he was defending the enslavement and sale of 9- and 10-year-old girls. But of course, you would be wrong. Even a cursory look, even just clicking one link past the Vox article to the letter in question, shows how misleading the left's anti-Columbus hysteria can be. In the letter in question, Christopher Columbus is not bragging about selling those girls into slavery. He's not defending it either. On the contrary, to the exact opposite, in the very next sentence, Columbus writes, quote, "I assert that the violence of the calumny of turbulent persons has injured me more than my services have profited me, which is a bad example for the present and for the future. I take my oath that a number of men have gone to the Indies who did not deserve water in the sight of God and of the world." How much more directly could he possibly condemn these people? He said they don't deserve water in the sight of God or the world. Anti-Columbus crusaders in recent years have focused most of their attention on a recently uncovered document from 2006 that allegedly exposes Columbus as the monster, vicious, genocidal, throw in whatever epithet you want, monster that they portray him to be. Headlines at the time of this document's discovery included, "Lost document reveals Columbus as tyrant of the Caribbean." "Columbus exposed as iron-fisted tyrant who tortured his slaves." "Christopher Columbus was actually punished for being a horrible person." And then my favorite, they really cut to the point, "Christopher Columbus was evil." That was a newspaper headline at the time. The news articles quote the most lurid and damning verses from this uncovered document, but they are all strangely silent on the nature and the author of the document itself. If you try to read it, you say, okay, but who wrote the document? What was the document? None of the articles will cover it. You actually have to do a fair bit of research to find out who it was. And when you do that, you find, unsurprisingly, that this report was written by none other than Francisco Bobadilla, Christopher Columbus's chief political rival and the man who successfully usurped power from him in the West Indies. This would be like pointing to a tweet from Hillary Clinton and using that as the sole and sufficient proof positive that Donald Trump was a really, 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 really bad guy. It said so right in the tweet. You can't, it was a tweet. A recently uncovered tweet. In reality, Christopher Columbus spent years of his life refuting this document as vicious libel, and he turned down, as a matter of principle, lucrative agreements with the Spanish crown that did not correct for history what Columbus viewed as baseless calumny. Now, this is not to say that Christopher Columbus is guiltless in the Spanish treatment of the natives. He's not. The greatest sailor of his age was not also the greatest colonial administrator. But the left's claims of Columbus's special monstrosity are without foundation. Even Bartolomé de las Casas, the first resident bishop of the Americas and the most vociferous defender of the indigenous islanders against Spanish slavery and brutality, admired Christopher Columbus to his dying day. He expressed as much in his History of the Indies. Stanford professor emerita Carol Delaney, another Columbus scholar, points out the ignorance, the central role of ignorance in all of this anti-Columbus nonsense. She says that these revisionists are, quote, blaming Columbus for things he didn't do. It was mostly the people who came after, the settlers. Her line, I just think he's been terribly maligned. And she's right, he has been terribly maligned by historically illiterate activists. Delaney points out that in Christopher Columbus's own writings, and in the writings of people who knew him at the time, Columbus seems to be, quote, very much on the side of the Indians. Christopher Columbus, by the way, even adopted a Native American son from an American Indian whom he had befriended who died. If this is not evidence that he's not a racist, anti-Native maniac, that he adopted one and raised him as his own son, also notice that in all of Christopher Columbus's writings, he never writes anything about the race of the islanders as some racial difference or some racial inferiority. It simply didn't happen. He didn't regard them as racially inferior. He didn't talk about the color of their skin. Now, we live in an era of fake news, so it is unsurprising that uneducated ingrates persist in attacking this great man. So let us quickly, in the time we have remaining, dispel some of the most pernicious lies and confusion. Who was Christopher Columbus? Cristoforo Colombo was born in 1451 in Genoa, Italy. Some people say he was born on like planet Mars. They have all these crazy conspiracy theories. No, no, he was Italian. To quote Tony Soprano, he was a brave Italian explorer, and in this house he's a hero. He was born to no rank and received no education other than the extensive self-instruction into which he poured his sizable genius. No portraits were painted of Columbus during his life. So actually, even the portraits that we're discussing right now, the murals, may be completely physically inaccurate. Bartolomé de las Casas describes Columbus as more than middling tall, face long and giving an air of authority, aquiline nose, blue eyes, complexion light, and tending to bright red, beard and hair red when young, but very soon turned gray from his labors. He was affable and cheerful in speaking. He was sober and moderate in eating, drinking, clothing, and footwear. He was a gentleman of great force and spirit, of lofty thoughts, naturally inclined to undertake worthy deeds and signal enterprises, patient and long-suffering, and a forgiver of injuries, and wished nothing more than that those who offended him should recognize their errors and that the delinquents be reconciled with him. By 1480, Columbus had moved to Portugal, married the daughter of a nobleman, traveled to Iceland, Ireland, and Africa, and had his first son. Columbus educated himself, and he made his first pitch to sail westward toward what he thought was the Orient. The Portuguese crown rejected his proposal, so he traveled to Spain undeterred with his five-year-old son. At this point, a widower and in debt, particularly from the cost of burying his late wife in a manner befitting her noble rank, Columbus left quickly for Spain to pitch Queen Isabella on his vision to discover a new passage to the Indies. He spent 5 years preparing for this meeting. He spent 5 years combing the geographical texts of Marco Polo, Pliny, Pierre Dailly, and others to make his case before a royal committee. Would that American universities took scholarship as seriously as the illiterate, lowborn Christopher Columbus. At long last, after 8 years of lobbying the Spanish crown, King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella rejected his request, sad. Just as he was leaving town, that was to quote the president, just as he was leaving town, though, just as he was leaving, the keeper of the privy purse ran up. Columbus was on his way to go convince another crown to give him money. He was totally determined. The keeper of the privy purse convinced Queen Isabel to call him back, and Las Casas asserts that it was ultimately Columbus's personality and perseverance, far more than the plausibility of his crazy plan, that convinced the queen to fund him. Now, another reason that the left hates Columbus is because of his devout Catholicism. Columbus made a confession and received the Eucharist the morning he set sail. He said his Book of Hours privately in his own cabin. He instructed the youngest sailors to lead shipwide prayers every half hour for the entire duration of the voyage. He ended each day of sailing with a shipwide recitation of the Our Father, Hail Mary, Apostles' Creed, and Hail Holy Queen. Columbus had virtually no navigational tools at his disposal for the most difficult voyage ever embarked upon. He relied solely on the relatively crude tool of dead reckoning, which is basically exactly what it sounds like. It involves laying down compass courses and estimating distances on a chart. There is no evidence that Columbus even took an astrolabe on this first voyage. Along the way, Columbus had to put down several mutinies, but sheer force of will and confidence in the divine providence of his journey prevented him from agreeing to the sailors' demands to turn back for Spain. After several false landfalls on the night of October 11th, Columbus spotted a flickering light as that of a candle or a torch on the horizon. Several others on board attested to seeing the flash, but given the distances, the flame could not possibly have been a fire or a torch on the shore. No natural explanation has ever been given as to what the men saw, but within hours they spotted land. Now, what of the rough treatment of the natives? That's the big issue, isn't it? That's why we're throwing tarp over history and art at American universities. As happened elsewhere in European contact with primitive societies, think of the Mayflower and Thanksgiving, things started out pretty well. Columbus and his men encountered the naked Taino people on the island of San Salvador in the Bahamas. Everybody was peaceful, and Columbus specifically instructed his sailors not to take advantage of the Indians. The Tainos told the explorers about decidedly less peaceful tribes, which explained the marks and the wounds on the natives' bodies. Those tribes inhabited the Isla de Caribe, and they were known for two things: elegant cotton rugs and eating people. Settlers who entered their huts found precisely two things: cotton rugs, some of which they took and brought back to Spain, and large cuts of human flesh. Other native tribes informed them that the Caribs considered babies, born and unborn, a particular delicacy. The Caribs introduced the word cannibal into European languages. The Caribs of Dominica, historians relate, killed and ate anyone who came ashore, and they were not the only violent tribe among the natives. As is true throughout mankind, bellicosity and peacefulness vary from people to people, as we see in the juxtaposition of the peaceful Tainos and the cannibal Caribs. Natives destroyed the first settlement established by Columbus, killing all of the Spaniards present and burning their buildings to the ground. Even then, Christopher Columbus showed restraint when his council wanted to kill various natives in their midst. Another group of natives mugged Spaniards and stole their clothes. Although Alonso de Hoyada cut off the ears of one and captured three to be executed, Columbus intervened on the natives' behalf and let them live. It is important to remember, too, that these were the first colonial questions in all of history. Christopher Columbus had to pioneer not merely a geographic expedition, but a first ever matter of international diplomacy and domestic politics. Those who cast aspersions on the Admiral of the Ocean Sea right now might consider how they would have fared under such circumstances. Would they have fared perfectly? Would they have succeeded at everything they tried to do? Columbus's introduction of Spain to the New World was so significant for world affairs that he actually created a new ethnicity, Latinos. There would be no such thing as Latinos without Christopher Columbus. If you are a Latino, if you know a Latino, if you like a Latino, you have Christopher Columbus to thank for that. The people who want to get rid of Columbus, want to undo what Columbus did, might say, if you like your Latinos, you cannot keep your Latinos. Entirely backwards. When Columbus returned from his second voyage, he wore the coarse brown habit of a friar because he believed his difficulties in colonial governance were divine punishment for his personal pride. This was a self-aware man. This was a man capable of profound humility, which he regularly exercised. Columbus arrived in Santo Domingo on his third voyage in 1498 to find utter disarray and a revolt led by the local mayor, Francisco Roldan. In order to quell the revolt, Columbus agreed to humiliating terms, including the creation of a system called repartimientos and later encomienda, which extorted labor from the natives. Roldan had backed Columbus into a corner, and he acquiesced. Now, while Columbus may have been a weak governor, accusations of tyranny came from political rivals, and they were indulged by the crown primarily because the crown had not yet recouped their investment in his voyage. The allegations also gave the crown a pretext not to pay Columbus what they owed him, which Columbus spent years trying to recoup. And to seal his political fate, Francisco de Bobadilla, Columbus's chief political rival and the author of the left's favorite defamation of the man, was able to gain power before the Spanish crown knew that Columbus and Roldan had come to terms. The man who risked everything to discover the New World and institute the modern era was sent back to Europe in chains. Columbus explained his outrage and gave an important lesson for all of us on pride and historical judgment, which the left, in its undeserved self-adulation, has utterly ignored. He wrote, "They judge me there as a governor who had gone to Sicily, or to a city or town under a regular government, where the laws can be observed in toto without fear of losing all, and I am suffering grave injury. I should be judged as a captain who went from Spain to the Indies to conquer a people numerous and warlike, whose manners and religion are very different from ours, who live in sierras and mountains without fixed settlements, and where by divine will I have placed under the sovereignty of the King and Queen, our lords, another world whereby Spain, which was reckoned poor, is become the richest of countries." And this is the crux of why maligning our forebears is as ungrateful as it is ignorant. Because it must be nice, mustn't it? It must be nice to sit in the freest, most prosperous, most charitable country in the history of the world, and from a position of totally unmerited luxury, slander the man who made it all possible without even having the decency to read past a Vox.com headline on the subject. Cowards, ingrates, and moral narcissists throw tarp over the memory of the man without whom they would not exist. Those who have tracked Columbus's Christian piety in this brief history lesson will enjoy the coincidence that he died on the Feast of the Ascension in 1506. His last words echoed his Savior's, who said, "In manus tuas, Domine, commendo spiritu meum. Into your hands, Lord, I commend my spirit." Those who call him a murderer and a tyrant and whatever other nonsense they belch should consider some other words of Columbus, which he addressed to the Spanish sovereigns in his Lettera Rarissima. He wrote, quote, "Let those who are fond of blaming and finding fault, while they sit safely at home, ask, why did you not do thus and so? I wish they were on this voyage. I well believe that another voyage of a different kind awaits them, or our faith is naught." For those of you who didn't catch that last part, he's telling his preening detractors to go to hell, and so am I. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I think now we're going to open it to questions.
Yeah, so Michael's going to take some questions now. So if you'd like to ask him some questions, please line up in the back with my colleagues there. And then you can we'll guide you up here one at a time. And while you're lining up there, there's some ground rules we have to go through. First of all, your question has to be a question. Only one question a person, no follow-ups. All right, so you can go ahead and line up there. And
we also have a rule at the Daily Wire, which I strongly object to, but they make me do it. If you disagree with me, you get to cut the line. I think this creates terrible incentives. It convinces people to disagree with me. But that's the rule, so we got to play by it. All right.
Hello, my name is Brennan Burr. I'm a junior political science theology major here. I want to ask you talk a lot about the radical left. Would you lump Father Jenkins himself into that category, or do you believe that he has just kind of bought their arguments and hasn't really done enough in his own mind to kind of combat that? Would you consider him to be more of a victim of the radical left, or more of someone who you'd identify with that group you're describing? Of course.
You know, while we're alive, we have will and we have the ability to do the right thing and to fight back against people who are trying to destroy liberal education. I would never presume to know Father Jenkins's motives as a university president covering up art and history, lest the ignorant and the unreasonable are offended by it. But certainly the action itself of taking beautiful, priceless murals by the Vatican portraitist at the entrance to a university in the United States and covering them up is a cowardly decision. It is anti-intellectual, it undercuts the entire spirit of education, and it is profoundly wrong and cowardly. I would never presume to know his motives, I would never presume to know his excuses for making that decision, but it is a terrible decision nonetheless.
Hey, thanks for coming. My question is, so what do we do? Like, what's your suggestion and how do we, because the left obviously has control of like the education system, like what do we do to like take it back?
The educational system is pretty hard when you have university presidents encouraging the inmates to run the asylum and encouraging them to rip down the very basis of liberal education. And I don't mean only to pick on Father Jenkins. This has happened at my own alma mater of Yale University, where they encourage students to rip apart the curriculum, where now you can graduate with honors in the English department, having never read Shakespeare or Chaucer. This is not a problem unique to Notre Dame. It's true throughout the United States. Some university presidents have had courage and moral clarity, such as Mitch Daniels, the president of Purdue University, right here in Indiana. When the ridiculous anti-intellectual leftist mob came for him and tried to get him to cave on liberal education, he flatly told them no, and they've had no more insurrections, no more uprisings since then. I think some cowardly university presidents think that if they give the mob just a little bit, they give in a little bit to their commands, that then that'll be enough, because appeasement always works throughout history, doesn't it? Probably not. It's a terrible idea. And so we can look to the leadership of good university presidents, such as Mitch Daniels at Purdue. We can look, of course, to the think tanks. The conservative movement has done a good job at think tanks. That is one area where we've been able to flourish. We've been able to flourish through alternative media, not to pat ourselves on the back, but we put out podcasts every day that allow you to access information that is cut off by the gatekeepers of the mainstream media and the universities. And what we need to really look to do is look to cut off the sources of the problem. So right now, you and I, all of us taxpayers, fund tenured radicals who are in our institutions of higher learning, who have gutted them, who have turned them into an empty husk, a perverse husk of what they once were. We need to stop funding those institutions. We need to stop funding them through the government. We need to stop personally funding them. We have to have alumni cut off their donations. We need people who are alumni of Notre Dame, in particular, after this recent horrific decision to cut Notre Dame out of their will and their own universities that are undermining liberal education. And then hopefully we can convince tenured radicals to come back around and stand up for education in the United States and the greatest educational system, at least until recently, in the entire world. The only way that they're going to listen is if we vote with our pocketbooks and vote with our attention spans. And I think we're doing a good job of that, and we should ratchet it up even more every day.
Yeah, I wish I didn't have a time constraint because I have a lot of things I want to get through, but I'm going to read two quotes and ask how you justify this as, quote, a hero and, quote, one of the greatest men in history, as you said through your speech.
Where are your quotes from?
The quotes are from his journal.
From where?
In his journal.
His
journal.
From the Journal of Christopher Columbus.
Yes. Okay. In his journal, he says, quote, "Let us in the name of the Holy Trinity go on sending all the slaves that can be sold." He also says, quote, "The Indians are so naive. I will bring as much gold and slaves as you need." That actually was not in his journal. That was to the court in Madrid.
I assume it wasn't in his journal because he would be writing to himself. Right. So you're saying Christopher Columbus agreed in a letter to his bosses who were funding his voyage that he would fulfill the terms of his voyage? That's what you're saying? This is some shock.
There's two parts to it. The first one was from his journal, where he quite literally said, "Let us in the name of the Holy Trinity go on sending all the slaves." The second one was to the court in Madrid, appeasing them, saying, "Yes, let's go get all these slaves from..."
Well, you mentioned in the name of the Holy Trinity, Christopher Columbus baptized many natives. He did it personally. And he obviously was bringing the faith to the New World. You're at a Catholic university. If you believe that the faith is true and good and beautiful, as I do, as all Christians ought to do, then that's a wonderful thing to spread the gospel to people who have never heard it before.
I think you misheard the quote. The last part of the
quote. I don't think I misheard
important.
The quote, but you can repeat it if you like.
In the name of the Holy Trinity, what should we do in that name? Go on sending all the slaves that can be sold.
So he sent slaves to the New World. That is true. Back to Spain. That is true. That was part of the deal. And if you listen to my lecture, I'm not sure. I heard your question, but I'm not sure you heard my lecture. He agreed to the encomienda system as a political concession because he was outfoxed by a local mayor named Roldan. This was the cause of much of his consternation in the New World. It's the reason that Bobadilla was able to take over and usurp control from him in the West Indies. This is a political reality. This is not a beautiful thing. It's a terrible thing. Slavery is an awful thing. None of us disagrees with that. But for us now, as people who have benefited, all people of the whole world who have benefited from the greatest country, the most profitable, the most charitable, the most equitable, the most just, the one that allows you to stand there and ask me that question. For us to spit on that man who made all of it possible because he made some moral concessions in order to take the most ambitious voyage at that time in the history of man is so bizarrely ungrateful. It is so ignorant of historical and political realities as to be naive and sophomoric.
My question was, how can you justify calling him a hero? I agree.
I've just justified it. That's my explanation.
I think
you're standing on the shoulders of giants, and you think that you're flying, but you're not. We are dwarfs standing on the shoulders of that great man, and we spit down on him in our ingratitude. How pathetic.
All right, see you. What's up, Michael? I'm a big fan of the podcast, and it's a great honor to stand here in your excellency.
Excellent. You said excellent, right?
No, not execrable. And I was listening to the conversation on Tuesday, and somebody asked you if you were writing a book, and you answered that you were writing, in fact, a second book with words.
Well, yeah, you're using the word second a little liberally here. I don't, you know, maybe technically a second, yeah.
Yeah, so I was wondering, I know you shut down that question. You said you don't want to be on a timeline. It's commitment. But I was wondering if you could drop any clues or hints as to the
yes,
content.
I will a little bit. One thing I've talked about in this entire lecture tour that I've done with YAF, the COFEFE on campus tour, we've talked about the simple joys of being right. We've talked about why the right, as a matter of social science and just as a matter of our own anecdotes and our own qualitative understanding, is happier, is more content, finds greater purpose in life than the left. This is borne out not just in the United States, but meta-analyses across over a dozen countries, lots and lots of people have borne this out to be true. I would like to explore that question because, man, I'm having a great time. I am as joyful as you can be. I walk singing down the road and skipping down the lane. And I notice that my friends on the left don't do this. They yell and they shout and they scream and they're angry and they wear hats that are simulacra of genitals on their head. And I don't know what they're doing. They're just so upset. So as a matter of personal charity, I am trying to show them the political light so that they don't persist to live in such misery. A pleasure.
Hello, Knowles. Sam. So during your Politicon panel with Kirk and all of them.
The Charlie Kirk one, yeah.
Yeah. So you had said that you were for Guantanamo Bay, but also for due process, and then they kind of slammed you for it. I was wondering, Could you expand on that more? And then also like expanding on the due process only for American citizens, I'm assuming you also meant also legal immigrants here, and then Covfefe or the tears.
And Covfefe or the tears? Why is this an either or question? Why is the, listen, grace abounds, my friend. You can have it all. I'm happy. That's a wonderful question. I'm happy to expand upon it because, unfortunately, when I was in that Politicon room, none of us could really hear what anyone on the stage was saying, so I missed what's a very important question, which is the question of due process or constitutional rights or specifically Geneva Convention protection for terrorists, because that's really what we're talking about when we talk about Guantanamo Bay or enhanced interrogation techniques or whatever. I think, as to borrow the phrase of Andrew Clavin, that waterboarding jihadis should be an Olympic sport. I think it is not only morally neutral, I think it is a moral good. And the reason for this is that it is totally immoral to extend Geneva Convention protections to terrorists. What is a terrorist? A terrorist is an unlawful combatant in war. A terrorist is one who does not wear a regular uniform, who targets women and children and civilians, who does not abide by basic rules of law. The reason that we established the Geneva Convention protections is specifically to protect civilians in times of war. And in exchange for not targeting civilians, we will extend to you certain courtesies for your soldiers if they are captured. If you extend those same courtesies to terrorists who specifically target civilians, you undermine the entire Geneva Convention. You undermine the entire point of offering anybody these courtesies because there is no incentive then not to target civilians. So I think it is certainly quite a good to put unlawful combatants in war in Guantanamo Bay and not just interrogate them in an enhanced way, but do whatever you need to do to get information out of them. Now, when it comes to lawful combatants in war, when it comes to foreign nationals who are just walking around on the street in America, when it comes to American citizens, then of course I support due process. I think I support due process much more, certainly, than the left does these days. But those are wholly different categories, and there's a real moral confusion among people who see an American citizen or even a lawful combatant in war and a terrorist as morally equivalent. They are not morally equivalent. They are entirely opposite categories, and they should be treated as such.
That's okay. I'm going to try to keep this quick. So Father Jenkins, in his letter to the community, said that the purpose of the murals is to help Notre Dame's largely immigrant Catholic population feel more welcome in the U.S. at a time when anti-Catholic sentiments ran high. So recently, we had a campus inclusive climate survey, and a white Catholic male.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that again?
Campus inclusive climate survey.
Got it, okay.
So the white Catholic males were the ones that reported that they were the ones that felt most welcome at the university. And so a lot of different marginalized communities were the ones that felt not very welcome. So has the purpose of the murals not been fulfilled at Notre Dame? And should we not shift our focus to help those marginalized populations now feel more welcome as the Catholics were just a few centuries ago?
Why? I don't know exactly to whom we refer when we talk about marginalized communities. You'll remember in the United States, the largest mass lynching in American history was against Sicilians. Few people today would call Sicilians a marginalized community, except for me when people yell at me at my campus speeches. I suppose regardless of who the marginalized people are, the question is, why don't they feel welcome? Does the survey tell us anything about that?
Well, I think it's because I think you could break it down. First of all, the marginalized community aspect, it breaks it down into different races. So you can look at like Latinos, lesbian, gay, transgender, African-American.
Latinos don't feel welcome because there's a picture of the man who invented Latinos on campus. That's the depths to which our educational system has been degraded.
Okay. Well, I think the other part of it is you're looking at certain documents that have historical value, like from Bartolomé de las Casas and others, but I think that it's just not really factually accurate to say that some counterpoints aren't also just like bound in actual history.
What did I say that wasn't factually accurate?
No, but I'm like, people can have different opinions about Columbus and they're being recorded as historical facts.
Some people can have correct opinions and some can have incorrect opinions. And there are people today who have an incorrect opinion that he was some genocidal, bigoted maniac, which is clearly, patently refuted by the historical record. That's not a matter of preference or some subjective feeling. That's objective fact. It's an opinion, but it's a true opinion.
My last thing I guess I'll say to that is, there are primary sources on both sides that will say that Columbus is good or bad, and to say that only the side that disagrees with you is politically motivated,
what sources? I don't think it's correct. Sources are you specifically talking about?
The ones that not specifically you're discounting, but I don't have one on the top of my mind. But
exactly, and this is the problem, because in the absence of facts, in the absence, I don't mean to pick on you, I mean to pick on them broadly.
I didn't come with one specifically. I mean, if you gave me like a half hour, I could probably go find one.
You certainly think that you could. Yeah. In the absence of historical knowledge, people have replaced what was once historical knowledge with broad narratives based on ideology, based on the headlines of Vox.com articles. Mm-hmm. They say, surely there are primary sources on both sides of the question of Columbus's character. Surely there must be some legitimate primary source document that buttresses my totally random and arbitrary opinion that he's a genocidal anti-Indian maniac. The problem is, there isn't. There is one document, that is the one document that any of them assert as evidence that Columbus was some genocidal maniac, and the document was written by his chief political rival. Now, you can point to that and say that that has some merit. I'm not saying it's totally valueless just because he was a political rival, but the vast preponderance of evidence not only provides a different perspective, but utterly contradicts the narrative that the left is pushing about Christopher Columbus, because it is anti-historical. I think the fear here are the broad narratives. It is to say, well, maybe that particular fact isn't accurate, but it speaks to a larger truth. Maybe Jussie Smollett wasn't really attacked in the streets of Chicago by two white men who turned out to be gigantic Nigerian men that he was friends with, but... but it speaks to a larger truth, but it doesn't. You cannot be, to quote Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, morally correct, but factually incorrect. You have to be factually correct to be morally correct. And feel free to email me or tweet me with all of the abundant primary materials that you feel refutes the vast preponderance of historical knowledge that we know about Columbus, and I'll consider changing my opinion. But I won't change my opinion for some ridiculous Vox.com headline. Yeah.
I think the last thing is that the moral concessions that you think he made are being outweighed by some of the like good things he might have done or did do. I think some people just think that those are too immoral to like outweigh.
So right. I think that people have great moral narcissism, including the people who have decided to throw tarps over this the murals in this university. And I think, to quote Dean Inge, that the man who marries himself to the spirit of the age will find himself a widower in the next, because we have such moral certitude today, happy as we are, in this luxurious society that was built on the back of Christopher Columbus because of his bravery and moral clarity. And there have been moral advancements that have been made since the time of Columbus that perhaps he would have understood, perhaps he wouldn't have understood. That's totally beside the point. But we are looking back now with perfect 2020 hindsight. And frankly, we are not looking forward to the future with perfect 2020 vision. And I think that, to use just one example, in the United States today, we kill 1 million babies a year. I suspect when people look back in the future and they look back on our time, they will find us, every one of us who tolerates that in this culture, to be far more barbaric, far more morally condemnable than Christopher Columbus, who made moral concessions, largely reluctantly, that do not even come close to what we are living in even today, and more importantly, to what we are utterly blind to.
Mr. Knowles, I don't know if you're familiar with Nicholas Taleb's book, Skin in the Game, but...
Not that one in particular, but okay. I like Nicholas Taleb.
Okay, but in it he says that majority opinion doesn't change things, it's intolerant minorities that do, and that's obviously what we've seen. It's an intolerant minority that's trying to shut down debate and erase history, and it seems to me that, you know, right-wingers in general seem to be more just want to debate instead of exert pressure. Now, is there a way that conservatives can nonviolently, of course, exert pressure and reverse this kind of erasure?
Absolutely, and I'm a strong advocate of doing that. I think one of the great temptations and pitfalls of the conservative movement and of the right broadly is to just live in the clouds, I don't want to be in the pish-posh, awful reality of this world. I don't want to have to ever make any moral concessions. I can just live up here in my literary and philosophical ivy tower and never have to deal in reality. And I'll lament the lost causes of the conservative movement, but, pish-posh, c'est la vie. I'm very much opposed to that. I think that we ought to exert quite a lot of pressure. I think specifically one example, we're talking about a university context, is that we should stop giving money to universities that behave this way. We should encourage our parents to stop giving money to universities that behave this way. And most importantly, we should convince our grandparents not to give money to them, because they have a certain lifespan curve working for them. And in their wills, they often leave a lot of money to university endowments that rely on them. And we should stop it. We should stop doing it. We should petition our government and vote for candidates who will defund universities that act in this childish way and that undercut liberal education in the United States. We should be tough. We should always be gentlemen about it, but gentlemen can be tough too. You don't need to back down. Just the other day, I don't mean to pick on Seth Mandel, I like him quite a lot, but he's a conservative writer, and he wrote just yesterday, he said, Jussie Smollett, he filed a false police report. He indicted half of America as bigots. He indicted our whole country as hopelessly racist. But he's clearly a troubled guy. He's clearly got a lot of psychological problems. Let's have compassion. I get it. That comes from a really good place. Charity is a wonderful virtue. But prudence and justice are virtues as well. And as Adam Smith said, mercy to the guilty as a matter of national policy is cruelty to the innocent. And as we indulge the hysterical rantings of these overgrown children at our universities, Notre Dame or Yale or anywhere else, that we create terrible perverse incentives. We have so much to lose. We so degrade our culture. I think we should be as tough as we possibly can. Of course, nonviolent, but never feel that you're above it all. Get there in the fight. If being in the fight means that you don't feel morally pure 100% of the time, that's politics, that's reality. We live in a real world, we live in time and space, we're not floating brains, we have real bodies, and we are called upon to do real things in the world. Yep.
Howdy. Thanks for giving this talk. I really enjoyed it, and I agreed with most of it, but I thought that there was one point you made that had some interesting implications. You said at one point that, or you decried the fact that this university was covering up art and history by covering up the murals. And I'm wondering what you think about that same logic being applied to Confederate statues in the South.
I think it's ridiculous to knock down history. I think it's absurd. I think we ought to face our history every day, the good, the bad, and the ugly. George Orwell writes about this very famously. I think it's Winston's line in 1984, that once the party has taken control, there will be no such thing as history. There will be no such thing as yesterday. And they'll have the best motives. They'll be doing the right thing as they say it. And ultimately, there will not be even truth itself, nothing but the ever-present political party. Ever present, ever changing. We're behaving like Stalin, erasing people out of official Soviet photos when we knock down those statues. It's absurd. It's a testament to the United States that the United States has overcome enslavement and exclusion and so much bigotry. It's a wonderful testament, and we should have those statues there to understand how we got here, to understand what those men were thinking, and to understand what has changed from now to then and how to preserve the gains that we have made while not destroying the tradition on which we all stand.
Haukola. My name is Mikey. I'm a member of the Rosebud Sioux tribe in South Dakota.
Are you related to Senatrix Warren or no?
No.
No.
No, okay. Unfortunately not. my question is, so I personally think that the Columbus murals portray warts in history, obviously, which I think should be portrayed. Would you also support an alternative mural depicting Lakota people scalping settlers.
Scalping the settlers.
Tanyan Manio.
Could you describe? Well, hold on. I want to speak with you. Okay, he doesn't want to answer. I suppose the question that he should answer is whether there is any comparison between some gratuitously violent display intending to degrade in the year 2019 some, I don't know if the fellow is even listening to the answer to his question, probably because he doesn't want to learn a thing, does he? If there's any comparison whatsoever from a beautiful 19th century mural, 12 of them, painted by the Vatican portraitist of one of the greatest men in history, to some modern attempt to portray gratuitous violence, I actually have no problem with some mural going up somewhere of depicting some of the gratuitous violence of whatever tribe that gentleman wants to be depicted. If he wants to depict that as the historical reality to remember, that's fine by me. I see no problem with it. And broadly speaking, if people want more art, if people want more discussion of history, not the revision of history, not the replacement of history with fantasy, but the actual discussion of history, warts and all, and there's a lot of warts in history, that has my blessing. I think that's a wonderful thing. And actually, I'm not surprised that the sort of person who would ask a question of a lecturer and then run out of the room lest he possibly learn something by hearing the answer, well, I'm not surprised at all that that sort of person would not would so clearly misunderstand the entire purpose of education.
Hi, Knowles. My question is, when in governance or making like decisions, when is a good time to use like a moral compass to make decisions for like abortion, murder, but then on the other side to use a practical decision-making series with decriminalization of like marijuana? When would like one be better than the other? Because it's, you know, obviously we want to make moral decisions, but we want to make sure, you know, have the best outcomes.
There's no but. Buts negate sentences. Everything that comes before the but, ultimately in political statements, gets totally ignored. You should always take into account the moral order when you're making public policy. There is not a dichotomy or some disagreement between practicality and morality. In fact, in the long run, the only thing that is practical is the moral order. Politics is downstream of culture. Culture is downstream of religion. The culture is defined by the cult, what the culture worships. And these are all part of the whole. There is a canard that goes around where people say, I don't think that we should legislate morality. Show me the legislation that does not legislate morality. Every argument I heard for socialist healthcare from Barack Obama was a moral argument. Of course, every argument against abortion is a moral argument, and in fact, every argument for abortion is a totally incoherent moral argument, including the arguments for raising and lowering taxes. When Bernie Sanders talks about soaking the millionaires and billionaires, he's making a moral argument, and so we should always be guided in that way. What you're asking is, when should we make moral concessions? And I think that we should do it very carefully and very cautiously. People now say, the best argument I've heard for legalizing pot is, oh, well, why not? It's like, well, it's whatever. Everyone smoked pot. It's fine. That's not a very good argument. And really what that argument says is there is a very motivated group of people in this country who are just so, I mean, the pro-legalization people are like the craziest, most enthusiastic group of voters ever. It's kind of funny because they're all potheads, so you'd think they'd be really chilled back. But they're so obsessed with this issue. And I think what happens when people are talking about a difference between morality and practicality is they say, oh, I just don't want to fight those crazy potheads anymore. Just let them smoke whatever they want to smoke. That's not a good way to make public policy. People have to stand firm. Fortitude is a virtue, and unfortunately politicians ignore that one the most, but really it is should always be at the forefront of their mind.
I know this is going to be the last question for the night.
Okay, they told me to keep this short, so but I think it's a really important question. I grew up watching a lot of westerns back in my day. Well, back, I'm only 20, but when I was younger, I watched a lot of westerns, and John Wayne, Clint Eastwood, you know. And
I can't help but draw the parallels between what's happening with Christopher Columbus and what's happening with John Wayne right now going on. And I guess my question is, what are the similarities and what can we do about that, like, as conservatives to kind of, because it seems like they're just kind of to smear somebody based on their beliefs rather than what their actual actions were.
That is such a good question and such a good observation. The first trouble that we have to get past is all of the cowardly conservatives who flop at the first sign of any leftist calling them a racist. Leftists call you a racist for buttering your toast the wrong way. They'll call you a racist for anything. It means nothing when they say it. And you have nothing to prove to people who advocate killing babies, not only in the third trimester, but apparently now in the fourth trimester as well. I owe them no answer. They have no modicum, not even an iota of moral superiority over me. I owe them no answer for their stupid accusations and insults. A lot of conservatives say, oh, I don't want to defend John Wayne in an interview from 40 years ago, even though he'd also died 40 years ago and he was born in 1907. I don't want to. No, he's terrible. I hate the Duke. How dare you? Give me a break. They do this with Columbus, too. Say, oh, well, it's just easier. Just they can have it. They can have it, and they'll slowly give away our whole civilization. I never thought that I would be defending John Wayne 40 years after he died, 47 years or 48 years after he gave this Playboy interview. He's getting a lot of flack for this because he said this line in the interview. He said, I would call myself a white supremacist until blacks are ready to take over the government. Is more or less what he said. And he used that phrase, white supremacist. So obviously, that's a very loaded phrase, and everyone backed off. This, I think, illustrates the entire point of this lecture tonight, is the left and cowardly conservatives refuse to read even the context in which he was speaking. He's speaking 3 years after the Civil Rights Movement as a very old tough guy that was born at the turn of the 20th century. That's some context. But even the context of what he said, because what he said was, blacks in this country resent public policy, perhaps rightfully so. Why? Because of enslavement, because of exclusion, because of bigotry. And part of what he's pointing out is that blacks had been excluded from education. And so then he makes his comments, which of course none would defend the use of the phrase white supremacy. None would defend the comments of a man 3 years after the Civil Rights Movement had ended. By the way, the comments of an actor, we talk about today why we shouldn't be looking to actors as our great political philosophers. The same was true in the 1970s. But if you listen to what he was actually making, the premise of what he was saying was actually an anti-racist point. It was acknowledging the reality of exclusion of people based on race and admitting the immorality of that. But of course, the left won't open their ears. The left are all like that kid who thought that he was making some sort of point. I don't know what point he was making, but he thought he was making one. And then he hightailed it out of the room before he would ever have to even have the possibility of listening to an answer or having a conversation. That's like the left. They close their ears and they say, la, 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 la. I can't hear you. I can't hear John Wayne. Russell Kirk makes this point in The Conservative Mind. He shows two types of reformers. The radical reformer, the reformer that we would call the leftist, looking back at some institution or some idea or some law in history and asking, is it true? Is it true? And if it's not, you're going to throw it all away. And then the more intelligent reformer who looks back at his history and asks, what does it mean? What did John Wayne mean? What did it mean that he was saying what he said at the time? What did it mean that we had just had a civil rights movement not 3 years prior? What does it mean that Christopher Columbus spent 8 years of his life preparing for a meeting to get funding to sail to the New World on an impossibly ambitious vision that meant near certain death to bring the light of Christ to the New World? What does it mean that the expedition required moral compromises? What does that say about us? What does it mean? That is an openness and a curiosity and a bit of awe and humility before our tradition, before education. And as our educational institutions encourage students to turn all of that off, to be so proud of their ignorance, to run out of a room before they could ever hear an answer to the question that they weren't even really asking, well, that is a great shame. And unfortunately, that is taking hold not just here at Notre Dame, but at universities around the country. And unfortunately, that darkness over the light of education only appears to be getting worse. I hate to leave you on a sad note, but that's just the way it is, guys. Let's hope that we can rip the covers off those murals and have a little bit of history and a little bit of art, because this is a university. Thank you very much. Thank you all very much. It's a pleasure to be with you.